Alhamdulillahi wa kafa wa salatu wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhina astafa khususan ala afdalihim wa khatamin nabiyyin Muhammadin al-Amin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa ba'd. We begin with Allah's blessed name. We praise Him and we glorify Him as He ought to be praised and glorified. And we pray for peace and for blessings on all His noble messengers, and in particular on the last of them all, the Blessed Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Our chairman is Muhammad Abrahams from Cape Town, who is my webmaster, who created and has maintained the website imranhosein.org for the last 10 years now. And we are proud and happy to have him with here tonight with us, inshallah, in Geneva. And on my left is Hasbullah, who is a scholar of Islam, who just recited from which surah? Which surah? Surah Al-Kahf, that's right. And Hasbullah is my assistant who will be teaching Ilmu Akhir Zaman, Islamic Eschatology, at the institute that we are establishing in the north of Malaysia. But more about him later on, inshallah. I will be speaking for maybe 1 hour. And then after that, we want the hall to be cleared. We want you all to go downstairs and get to know each other. You spend about half an hour getting to know each other. It's important. And then when you come back up after half an hour, then we'll have the question and answer session, which is devoted only to the topic. So don't ask me about Trump. After we've had the question and answer session, then we can have the general session, as our chairman explained, in which you can ask all the questions you want on any other subjects. But tonight, our topic is the Qur'an and the beginning of history, Awwal Zaman. Do we have any Orthodox Christians present? None, okay. We were expecting some of our Orthodox Christian brothers here tonight. We begin with the verse of the Quran, which is directly related to our topic. I'm speaking slowly, because there are some who don't know English too well. My two little granddaughters there. and I'm using simple language so that those who are French speaking would try to understand, inshallah. In Suratul Hadid of the Quran, the surah on iron and steel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks, and it is ayah number 3 of surah number 53, but Suratul Hadid. And this is what he says. Whenever you are quoting from the Quran for the first time, you always say, بَعَدَ أُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ, and then you quote. Afterwards, you can quote from the Qur'an. So, بَعَدَ أُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ هُوَ الْأَوَّلُ وَالْآخِرُ وَظَاهِرُ وَالْبَاطِنُ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. Nothing happens in the Qur'an by accident. Nothing. Every single word. He is the first. So he is at the beginning of history. le commencement de l'histoire. And he is the last. So he is at the end of history, le fin de l'histoire. If he is at the beginning, and he is at the end, then he connects them both. So there is a connection between the beginning and the end, between the beginning of history and the end of history. If you want to study Akhiru Zaman, you must study Awwal Zaman, Awwal Zaman. If you want to understand the end of history, you must study the beginning of history. And tonight, we will look at the first page of history and see what is there on the first page of history, the first paragraph, and then we'll try to link it tonight with the end of history. But the verse goes on to say that he is also that which is external, and he is also that which is internal, that which is apparent and that which is hidden. And it ends with the statement that he has knowledge of all things. In other words, the reference to first and to last, and to outward and to inward, all of this is connected with knowledge. So, how is first and last connected with outward and inward? The answer is that in order to study the beginning and the end, and to be able to locate that which connects them, you have to adopt a certain method of study. And that method of study is one which links the outward with the inward. This is called, it's a big word, don't be scared with it. This is called epistemology. Very big word, but don't worry. Epistemology, a theory of knowledge. That knowledge is not based only on the study of that which is external. No. If you want to study, you need more. The knowledge that is externally acquired. You need also knowledge which is internal, batin, knowledge which is internally received. We have with us Dr. Jamal, who is an excellent poet. And he has written on this subject of the external and the internal. He's sitting right here in front of me. Do we have a model in which this epistemology is applied so we can follow that model? Yes, Remember, Suratul Kahf is the surah of Akhiru Zaman, eschatology. And in Suratul Kahf, there is a model. The story begins outside of the surah in Sahih Bukhari, and then it comes to the surah, where we are told that the most learned of all men, the most learned scholar of all, who is the model of scholarship in Akhiru Zaman, you will find him at Majma'ul Bahrain. You will find him at the place where the two oceans meet. They don't teach this in any university. No. You're not going to get this from a university. He is Khidr alayhi salam. And this is my little book. I love this one the most. And you can read this book in less than 1 hour. In Search of Khidr's Footprints in Akhiru Zaman. This is the French, but we also have the English downstairs. So we need to combine the two oceans. They have to be harmoniously integrated, and Khidr has done that. What are the two oceans? You're all familiar now that our view is that it is not Atlantic Ocean and Pacific Ocean or Indian Ocean. Rather, it is the ocean of knowledge, which is Zahir, which is externally acquired, and it is the ocean of knowledge which is Batin, which is internally received. These two oceans of knowledge, when they are harmoniously integrated in a scholar, you now have the only one who can study Awwal al-Zaman and Akhir al-Zaman and locate the nexus, that which binds them together. Our tragedy is that this is no longer taught in the Darul Uloom. So we are no longer producing the scholars of Islam who can walk in the footsteps of Khidr alayhi salam. This epistemology, that in order to study the world today and penetrate its reality, political reality, economic reality, monetary reality, military reality, that you need to see with more than these eyes. You have to be able to see with the internal eye. Before we end on the subject of epistemology, let us recall that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in introducing Khidr alayhi salam, I'm sorry that my friend Mika is not here, the Orthodox Christian, he's coming later. Mika said to me, when I introduced him to Khidr alayhi salam, he said, but he resembles Jesus. Everything you said about him is the same thing like Jesus. Mika is coming later, inshallah. Allah said about Khidr alayhi salam two things in Suratul Kahf. Ataynahu rahmatan min indina. Number one. Wa'allamnahu min ladunna ilma. Number two. That if you are to acquire the capacity to study and penetrate the world today, and to follow in the epistemology of Khidr alayhi salam, you have to receive from Allah rahmah. And then you have to display rahmah. Rahmah is most of all kindness. To be kind at all times. And sometimes you really have to be patient to be kind. Oh, I tell you that. You need plenty sabr, patience. Plenty, plenty, plenty. So prepare yourself. If you want to study the world today, prepare yourself. You need plenty sabr, patience. And then you have, with that patience, to show kindness, to be kind at all times. To be kind in such a way that even the surprise, they will be surprised at this man or this woman is still so kind. Secondly, that knowledge must come to you from Allah. But Allah says in the Qur'an, and I don't want to spend too much time with this because I have to move on. He says, وَأَلَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى, meaning, if you do not plant, you cannot reap. Huh? I hope you like my translation. وَأَلَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى, meaning, if you do not plant, you cannot reap. If you want nur from Allah and ilm from Allah, you got to work for it. And to work for it, the heart must be turned to Allah. When the heart is turned to Allah, and the heart embraces the truth that has come from Allah, then that is called faith. But Allah will test you to see whether you have faith, iman. And when the test comes, you say, no, if I talk like that, they say I'm a terrorist. So, better shut my mouth. No. If I keep a beard, they say I'm a terrorist. Let me shave off the beard. No. If I keep the hijab on, they say I'm a terrorist. Let me take off the hijab. No. I can't talk like this. If I talk like this, then I will lose my job. Oh, I won't get a promotion. Or they put my name on a no-fly list. Do you think all of these things are happening by accident? No. Allah is testing. He's testing. I can't speak like this. I can't act like this. My business will collapse. وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ. Be conscious of the fact Allah is there watching your heart. Watching your heart. Checking it out. If you are sincere with Allah. And I will proclaim the truth regardless of consequences. Now, I'm holding on to this deen, even if I have to make hijrah from France or hijrah from Austria or hijrah from Switzerland. Even if I have to pack my suitcase and go, I am going to hold on to this deen. Yeah? Even if I have to go to the mountain sides where rain falls and take with me some sheep and goats and live there. I'm going to hold on to this deen. Who said these words? That a time will come when a believer, in order to hold on to his faith, would have to flee to the mountain sides and to places where rain falls. Fleeing with his deen. These are the words of Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. He's testing us. This is akhiru zaman. And these events are not occurring in the world by accident. No. We're being tested. And he warned us that holding on to Islam in Akhiru Zaman would be like holding on to hot. Ah, yes, you know it. Hot coals. So if you're eating your chicken biryani and going home and sleeping and all is well in the world, something is wrong. If you are holding on to Islam at this time, it should be like hot coals in your hand. So the conclusion now of my introduction on epistemology is that if you are to qualify to study in the footsteps of Khidr alayhi salam, you have to be sincere with Allah. There's much more we could talk on this. We could go to Surah An-Nur. We could go to Ayat An-Nur. Allahu Nuru Samawati Wal-Ard. We can go to the glass and the lamp and the oil. But we don't have the time to do that now. When we turn now to the beginning and the end of history, and how they are connected, we find, this is in Surah Ar-Rum, I think, yes. لِلَّهِ الْأَمْرِ مِنْ قَبْلِ وَمِنْ بَعْدِ. Allah commands, Allah's authority prevails at the beginning, and at the end, that which came before and that which came after. وَيَوْمَ إِذٍ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. The immediate reference in this ayah is to the victory of Rum. غُلِبَتْ الرُّومُ. But then afterwards, Rum will be victorious. But the other implication of this ayah, before and after, beginning and end, is that at the end of history, the believers are going to celebrate. History is going to end in such a way that the believers, those who have faith, will celebrate. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, he said about him, وَالَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُظْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا. Three times in the Quran. He it is who has sent his messenger Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam bilhuda. Oh, but guidance didn't start with him. Guidance came with all the prophets of Allah. This is the last one. So the guidance has been coming all the time. And now with Muhammad, Allah's blessings be upon him, the guidance has come again. Bilhuda. Wadeen ilhaq. And the way of life based on al-haq. Hold on to that word. Al-haq. Truth. It didn't come for the first time with Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. No. Truth or al-haq has been coming all the time. All the time. It came with Moses, Nabi Musa alayhi salam. I have to translate my Arabic term. We have one from Brazil here who is not a Muslim. She's here. I have to translate the terms from Arabic to English. It came with Nabi Musa alayhi salam, the Prophet Moses. It came with Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam, the Prophet Abraham. It came with Nabi Isa alayhi salam, Jesus. So truth did not come for the first time with Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. I said to her when she asked me about the religion of the indigenous Indians of Brazil. I said, oh, but their religion appears to be superior to the one which came from Europe. The American Indians. Because they considered a river to be sacred. And they would not pump their industrial waste into a river. And they would not pump their sewage into rivers. No. They would be horrified. Because the river is sacred. She was almost crying when I said that. The religion of the Indians seems to be superior to that which came from Europe. A bogus kind of Christianity. It couldn't be the religion that came from Jesus. No. Where you could pump all of these things and destroy your rivers. For the Indian, the tree is sacred. And we are familiar with that because there are trees in the Quran, many places. When Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam went up and up and up and up and up. At the last point was a tree, Sidratul Muntaha. And Allah says about the Quran, in the Quran, about human beings. Listen to the construction of the words. In Surah An-Nuh, Wallahu ambatakum min al-ardi nabata. He doesn't say, Allah has created for you from the earth. Trees and plants. No. Ambata lakum. No. Ambatakum. Allah has created you from the earth. Like trees and plants. That's the Arabic construction. And so they consider the tree to be sacred. And the Quran says so. So truth has come to many people before it came to us. Be careful. And it is that truth, that universal truth, that eternal truth, which has been coming to mankind for so long before it came in the Quran, that will triumph in the end. So are we the only people who are going to be happy at the end of history? So now we have a nexus, a connection between the beginning and the end. That at the end of history, those who have faith in the truth will rejoice. We turn now to this exciting part of the subject. The first page of history. And it's such a pity that we don't have our Orthodox Christian brothers here with us, because it will do them well to hear what the Qur'an has to say about the first page of history. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the human being from clay, from dust, from mud. He says so. And then having done that, وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي وَنَفَخْتُ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِي That's what it says. And I, this is first person now, I, first person singular, وَنَفَخْتُ First person singular. Otherwise Allah says, we did this, we did that. But here he says, I did it. So watch out when he says, I did it. وَنَفَخْتُ And I breathe it into him. From my ruh. Oh. I breathe it into him. Of my ruh. My ruh is divine. And I am breathing something divine into him. And then he said to the angels, فَقَعُوا لَهُ سَاجِدِينَ Bow down and prostrate before him. So we ask the question, when the angels were asked to bow down and make sijda, prostrate before him, are they prostrating before the clay, the mud? Or are they asked to prostrate before that which is divine and breathe it into him? Huh? I mean, you have to have a PhD in ignorance. That's what he had, Iblis. To come to the conclusion that Allah is asking me to make prostration before the clay. So they all made sijda except Iblis. Then Allah asked Iblis, when I ordered you to make sijda, to prostrate, why didn't you do it? And then he answered, and this is the answer we want to remember in the politics of Akhiru Zaman, in the civilizational struggles of Akhiru Zaman, we must proclaim this truth. He said, oh, but I am superior to him. I am born superior to him. I have a birthright of superiority to him because you created me from fire and you created him from clay. Oh, no, Iblis, how can you be so stupid? It is not the clay that you ask to bow and prostrate to. Iblis, every human being by virtue of being a human being, whether he is from Africa and he is black, or he is from Europe and he is white, or he is from China and he is yellow, or he's come from the Arab world and he's light brown, or he's come from India and he's darker brown, and it is a human being. He's a human being. And all human beings, all every single human being has this in him and her, that Allah has breathed of his ruh. So you miss the boat, Iblis, with your arrogant claim to superiority as your birthright. Allah goes on in the Quran to say, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ. Watch it. Every human being, including the Zionists, by virtue of being a human being, is honored by Allah. Now, this first page of history and this first paragraph has amazing implications for Akhiru Zaman. Because as you've guessed already, in Akhiru Zaman we have a people, an arrogant people who proclaim themselves to be the chosen of the Lord God. We are the elite of mankind. And all the rest of mankind are inferior to us. That's what I heard in the classroom, the Graduate Institute of International Studies right here in Geneva. I was a student here. And in the classroom of international politics, that's what I was hearing. It's called jingoism. That we have a divinely ordained mission to civilize the world. Modern Western civilization is satanic. Yes. It is following exactly in the stupid footsteps of Iblis. This didn't happen by accident. That a satanic force should emerge on the page of on the stage of history, not by accident, claiming to be superior to all the rest of mankind, and claiming that it has a mission to civilize all of mankind. Yes. And that's what they did. So now, when Nabi Isa alayhi salam returns, as he'll come back, and you offer him some chicken biryani, huh? And he pulls up his sleeves and he washes his hands, and Nabi Isa alayhi salam begins to eat with the cutlery that Allah created, you know. Modern Western civilization will come and tell him, hey, you uncivilized man, that's not the way to eat. Civilized people don't eat with their fingers. No. To be civilized, you must stop eating with your fingers, with your hands. To be civilized, you must now use cutlery. You see the arrogance? We are a people born to civilize the world. So today, from Le Centre de l'Espérance, on Rue de la Chapelle, we say to them, because of our study of Awwal Zaman, that you are an arrogant people. Aba wastakbara wa kana min al-kafirin. Allah said to him, Iblis, get out. You are arrogant. And arrogance will not be allowed in paradise, in heaven. No arrogance in paradise, in heaven. And so if the Arab, we have Arabs here, considers himself to be born superior to the non-Arab, the Imran is non-Arab. By virtue of being an Arab, I'm superior to the non-Arab. Oh, okay, you're now following in the footsteps of Iblis. Huh? If the Malay says, I'm superior to the Chinese, by virtue of being born, then you are following in the footsteps of Iblis. And if the fair-skinned Indian from India and Pakistan looks down upon the dark-skinned Bangladeshi, and the fair-skinned Arab looks down upon the dark-skinned Yemeni, oh, I have news for you. You're following in the footsteps of that fellow, that stupid fellow, in the first paragraph of the first page of history. Then we are told in the second paragraph now of the first page of history that Allah spoke to the angels. Or incidentally, I think you probably already, all of you know, maybe just one or two, so let me just rapidly repeat it. Proper methodology. Allah is teaching methodology for study of the Quran. He says, I ordered the angels to prostrate, to make sujda before Adam. And all of them did it except one, Iblis. If you use the wrong methodology of taking this verse of the Quran or a verse of the Torah or a verse of the Gospel in isolation by itself, then you come to the conclusion Iblis had to be an angel. Yeah, can't get away from that. He had to be an angel. Why? Because the order was given to the angels. And they all obeyed except him. See? The sentence is constructed this way to teach methodology. Don't make the mistake of coming to a conclusion based on the study of one verse of the Quran or the Torah or the Injil or the Gospel in isolation. Otherwise, you can make a mistake and you'll be very embarrassed afterwards. See? This is why this verse is constructed like this. I ordered the angels to make prostration. They all did except this one. That is why, to teach methodology. But when you go to the whole book, now you're no longer a schoolboy, now you're a scholar. When you go to the whole book, then you find that angels don't have a choice. No. When an angel is given an order, the angel must obey. But he disobeyed. Therefore, he cannot be an angel. Mika. This is Mika. We've been waiting on him all the time. Mashallah. Welcome, Mika. angels have to obey. But he disobeyed. So he could not have been an angel. See? And then when you go to the rest of the book, what kind of mean a jinn? He was not an angel, he was a jinn. So I'm just taking this, by the way, to warn you, you must have proper methodology for studying the Quran, for studying the Torah, for studying the Gospel and so on. Good. So Allah spoke to the angels and said to them, this is now the second paragraph of the first page of history. And he said to them, I'm going to place on earth one who will be Khalifa, an Arabic word. Hold on to it for a little while if you don't mind. Khalifa, okay? I'm going to place on earth one who will be Khalifa. All right. So what do the angels say? Now, they have no knowledge except what Allah teaches them. An angel can't go and do research, you know. No. They say in response, oh, they're horrified. Why are they horrified? Because they already know. Because Allah has already told them that this business of Khalifa is going to cause the historical process to be filled with facade, that which corrupts and also destroys while corrupting, and also bloodshed. Why are you doing this? When this is going to result, Khalifa, this is going to result in facade and in bloodshed, universal facade. Facade, remember? That which corrupts but destroys as well, destructive corruption. That by placing on earth this human being, you are now and appointing him as Khalifa, you are now going to allow the historical process to be filled with facade and bloodshed. So what is this Khalifa, which is so bad? It's, the angels are horrified. Allah responds and says to them, I know what you don't know. There's more to the subject that you don't know. There is more to the subject of Khalifa that you do not know, which justifies my placing human beings on earth. Then he taught Adam alayhi salam the rest of the subject concerning Khilafah, concerning Khilafah. I have not as yet translated Khalifa for you, okay? No. And having given to Adam alayhi salam the complete knowledge that the angels did not have on the subject, all that they knew about the subject is that this Khalifa is going to cause facade, corruption which destroys, and bloodshed, rivers of blood. So he taught to Adam alayhi salam. So now Adam alayhi salam has full knowledge of the subject of Khilafa. And then he says, he places the subject before the angels. Come on, tell me. They say, we have no knowledge. Okay, Adam, you tell them. And he then noted. And having informed them, now the angels now have the full knowledge that they didn't have before. Then he gave the angels the order to prostrate before Adam, alayhi salam. And they all prostrated except this one, Iblis. So what is this Khilafah? Something very important. Because it's there on the first page of history, second paragraph. To answer the question, we don't need to go to a university or a professor. We go back to the Quran. That's where we could get the answer. And when we go back to the Quran, we go to Surah As-Sad, 100 times I'll keep on repeating this verse. Listen to it. Allah speaks to Dawood alayhi salam, David. And I'm so happy that my brother Mika is here now. He says, "Ya Dawood, O David, inna ja'alnaka khalifatan fil ard." O David, I am appointing you as khalifa on earth. Oh, now we're getting some more knowledge about khilafah. David is khalifa on earth. So now, what is your function as khalifa? Fahkum bayna an-nas bil haqq. Oh. So a khalifa is one who governs. We're talking here about governance. A khalifa is one who rules. A khalifa is one who establishes law. Oh, this is heavy business now. We're talking about a state. On the first page of history, in the second paragraph, we are told that Allah placed us here on earth to establish a state, which is a Khilafah state. And the David, Nabi Dawood alayhi salam, he establishes the Khilafah state. And the Khilafah state is one in which governance is based on al-haq or truth. And remember, truth did not come in the Quran for the first time. Don't be so foolish. Truth has been coming all through history. Truth even came to the Brazilian Indians, who showed so much respect for a river. They don't go hunting buffaloes for fun, as Europe did. Killing them for fun. I don't know what kind of religion came out of Europe. It could not be the religion that came from Jesus, alayhi salam. No, it came from somebody else. And so, Khalifa has to establish a state in which governance is based on truth, and truth is eternal, and truth is universal. Truth is perennial. I'm sorry, my language is becoming a little bit too difficult now for those who are French speaking. Truth is eternal, forever. Truth is absolute, it comes from Allah. Truth is universal, it has always been there in history. And truth has come for the last time here in this book, the Quran. And the Khilafah state is the state in which law is based on truth. Governance is based on truth, which has come from Allah, not from Washington. But then the verse goes on to say something more. Allah warns David, alayhi salam, Dawood, وَلَا تَتَّبِي الْهَوَىٰ. O David, do not swerve from establishing law based on truth, which has come from Allah, and pursue your own agenda based on what your mind, your heart, your rational faculty tells you to do, that you will discuss in Parliament and you will decide in Parliament. Don't govern on the basis of that. وَلَا تَتَّبِعِ الْهَوَىٰ فَيَدِلَّكَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. If you do that, you're going to be misguided from the way of the Lord. I think you're beginning to understand now what's coming. Huh? What Dajjal has done today. I think you're beginning to understand. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَدِلُّونَ عَن سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ لَهُمْ. Or this part makes you shake. لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ شَدِيدٌ بِمَا نَسُوا يَوْمَ الْحِسَابَ. Surely those who depart from governance, from rule, from establishment of law based on the truth which has come from the Lord God, all through history, with Moses, with Jesus, with Abraham, with David, with Solomon, with all of them, those who depart from that truth to pursue their own agenda, for them there is terror, and who are consequently misguided, for them there is terrible punishment because they forgot the day of accounts. Okay. So that's Awwal Zaman. Now look at Akhir Zaman. Is there anywhere on the face of Allah's earth? Anywhere? Not even in Russia, which is now returning to Christianity, to Orthodox Christianity. Not even in Russia that is returning to Orthodox Christianity. Nowhere on the face of the earth. Most certainly not in Saudi Arabia. Oh, come on. Not even in Iran. Nowhere on Allah's earth today. Is Allah's law supreme? Nowhere. Rather, we now have a model of a state which is the opposite of the Khilafah state. It's called a Republican state. And a Republican state is one in which governance is of the people, by the people, for the people. Have you heard it? Did you hear it? Remember? That's the Republican state. Of the people, by the people, for the people. Oh, so the people have now taken over from the Lord God. This is for يَدِلَّكَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Around the world in Akhir Zaman we have this. And nobody cries. There's no tears. No, everybody eat the chicken biryani and go home and sleep. That's what we do. No heart is weeping. None. The Byzantine Empire, the Orthodox Christian Byzantine Empire, was an empire that sought to recognize the supremacy of the Lord God. That's what they did. And along come a force which has to be recognized as evil, the Ottoman Empire, which destroys the Orthodox Christian Byzantine Empire with a bogus jihad. And this Ottoman Empire then proceeds to rule on the basis, it didn't come from Allah. Is this the truth? Is this the truth on which you are ruling? That you can now wage bogus jihad for 500 or 600 years on the innocent Orthodox Christians? And because you are empowered with a power that you can defeat them, when you defeat them, you take their women as slaves, and you have something called a harem. I don't know where it came from, the harem. Filled with Orthodox Christian women as slaves, and you have your children with them. That's the new Islam, yeah, with the Ottoman Empire. And then when you defeat the Orthodox Christians, and they want to have a truce, part of the agreement, they got to hand over by force some of their Christian boys. You know it. Don't tell me you don't know it. And these boys are converted to Islam by force. And if you refuse, you're killed. This is the new Islam. Yeah. And then these boys are trained to become the elite fighting force of the Ottoman Empire, the Janissary. And so when the Ottoman army goes to fight the Christian people, their own sons are the elite fighting force fighting against them. This is putting salt in a wound. And then they take the capital city of the Orthodox Christian world, Constantinople, with its major cathedral, Hagia Sophia, a Christian cathedral, and Allah asks you in the Quran to protect them. Protect them. That's what He says in the Quran, Surah Al-Hajj. And they take the Orthodox Christian cathedral, which has been the major cathedral of the Orthodox Christian world for 1,000 years, and they convert it shamefully into a masjid. Is that truth? Huh? No, that can't be truth. Truth is always just. There's justice in truth. And this is unjust, what you've done, to take a Christian cathedral and convert it into a masjid. So at the first page of history, we have the obligation as human beings placed on earth who have faith in the one God, the obligation to establish a state in which governance and rule and law will be based on the truth which has been coming to mankind from the time of Moses and Abraham, Allah's blessings be upon them, until the time of Muhammad, Allah's blessings be upon him. That state no longer exists today because of a people who have taken over the world and have prohibited the establishment of such a state. I have one more paragraph. A Pakistan which says that it is an Islamic republic. An Iran which says that it is an Islamic republic. And I don't know how many others are saying, oh, but there's only one state, only one, for which you can use the word Islamic. Only one. If there's a second one, let me know. Has it come by email from Disneyland? Only one. It's a Khilafah state, that's all. So if you say you are an Islamic state, the implication is you are a Khilafah state. Can a Khilafah state, which has an obligation to establish Allah's law as the supreme law, which has an obligation to govern on the basis of truth which has come from the Lord God, can a Khilafah state be a member of the United Nations organization? Huh? When Articles 24 and 25 of the Charter of the United Nations declares that the Security Council has supreme authority in the world? No? No? But Pakistan declared it's an Islamic state. Yeah. Can an Islamic state be also a republic? You are a Khilafah state, meaning Allah is supreme, but a republican state, meaning of the people, by the people, for the people. You cannot be both an Islamic state and a republican state. No, you cannot be both an Islamic state and a republican state. No, 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 no. But that's what they say. Yeah. It sounds very foolish. Nowhere today do we have a Khilafah state. On the contrary, we have a bogus substitute called the Islamic Republic. I told them that in Iran, they were not too pleased with me. And now if that was not bad enough, we have ISIS. Or we have Daesh, which now says that we are going to establish the Khilafah state, and you have the Khalifa, his name is Baghdadi. Huh? But do you establish a Khilafah state with a jihad based on weapons that come, you know, Santa Claus? Santa Claus, he has a reindeer come in the sky, Christmas time. And Santa Claus is providing state-of-the-art weapons to them. Oh yeah, missiles. All the machinery to them, everything that they need, Santa Claus bringing it for them. Santa Claus providing all the American dollars. Yeah. Santa Claus protecting them. This fellow Santa Claus, I wonder why he's so much interested in this Khilafah state. No, no, you can't fool us. You cannot establish a state based on truth while taking weapons and taking money and taking training from those who are waging war on the truth and seeking to destroy the truth in the world. So tell Baghdadi, this is a false jihad. We come now to the last paragraph that we need for tonight, and then we stop. After Allah had said to the angels, make sijda, make prostration before Adam. After that event, He then announced to Adam, alayhi salam, you and your wife go and live in paradise. so marriage is something for paradise, eh? Marriage is not for tears on her pillow every night that she sleeps. Marriage is not for pots and pans flying all over the house, no. Marriage is for paradise. So if your marriage is not a heavenly marriage, something is wrong. Go and live in heaven and eat and drink from what is in heaven to your heart's content. وَلَا تَقْرَبَ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ Oh, but do not approach this shajara, this tree. Do not approach this tree. فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ Because that is the road to wickedness. Approaching that tree is the road to wickedness and to oppression and to injustice and so on. I'm so happy that Mika is here with us tonight. Which tree is it? Is it a mulberry tree or an apple tree? Which tree is it? The Salafi says, this is his methodology, and I have discussed it in this book, that if Allah and His Messenger and the early Muslims have not given ta'wil, interpretation, we have no right to interpret. Okay? But we don't have any interpretation for the tree. So the Salafi method is that you have to accept it's a literal tree, unless Allah and His Messenger. And the early Muslims have interpreted the tree to be something other than literally a tree. Which tree is it? Do not approach this tree. Because if you do, that's the road to wickedness and oppression and injustice. Zulm. So which tree is it? This is important. This is the beginning of history. Maybe this tree has implications for the end of history. I'm happy that Mika is here because there are differences now in what is found in the previous scriptures and what is in the Quran. And as we look at the differences, we must use the rational faculty to judge on this issue. And the heart must seek to locate the truth wherever it is to be found. The answer to the question, which tree is it, is to be found in Surah Taha, verse 120. Where Satan comes to Adam in paradise and speaks to him. And he says, Ya Adam, I'm here as a friend, huh? Let's talk. Hal adulluka ala shajaratil khuld wa mulkin la yabla? Adam, are you listening to me? May I explain to you the tree? Can I invite you to come to this tree, which is the tree of eternity, that you will live forever? That you will live forever. And also, that this tree is a tree of estate, mulk. And it is a state which will never decay. Never decay. Meaning eternal rule. Eternal life and eternal rule. And when they approach the tree, something happened. They lost their spiritual innocence because they're in heaven, in Jannah, so the spiritual life. And they became conscious of their nakedness. And they took the leaves of the trees of heaven to try to cover their nakedness. Now, the reason why there is this link with the sexual life, the reproductive organs, is because spiritual innocence was destroyed by the approach to the tree. The tree of eternal life, not the tree of knowledge at all, the tree of eternal life and the tree of eternal rule. That when a people have in their hearts the longing for eternal life, they are lusting for life. It is lust. And that lust for life destroys your spiritual innocence. And when a people want to rule eternally, because that is what Pax Judaica is all about. From Pax Britannica to Pax Americana to Pax Judaica, to rule eternally. When a people seek to rule eternally, that is a form of lust. And it is a lust which destroys spiritual innocence. And so they became conscious of their nakedness. And so anyone who has in his heart the lust for life, I want to live and live and live and live and live and live and live, you can't enter into heaven. On the contrary, the Christian who is a Christian, the Jew who is a Jew, the Muslim who is a Muslim would say, the Lord gives life and the Lord takes life. And blessed is the Lord. I don't want to live forever. I don't have a lust to live forever. No. Whenever he calls, I go. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. He created life and death to test you. To test you. He created life and he created death. To test you. And so if there's nuclear war coming, Sheikh Imran, where can I go to be safe? Where in the world? Tell me, I want to go. I don't want to die. A Muslim, like his brother who is a Christian, and his brother who is a Jew, is not afraid to die. No! We are not a people who lust for life. So we are not approaching that tree that Adam alayhi salam is prohibited. Do you see how we are tying the beginning with the end? Nor do we want to rule the world. We don't have that in our heart. And to rule eternally, that is what they want to do. They want a Pax Judaica, in which a holy state of Israel will rule eternally. And we say, that is the tree, that is the tree you are prohibited from approaching, because that's the tree to wickedness and oppression and injustice. So what we have here tonight, and I want to end now because I've taken you to the first page of history, and I take you to the first paragraph and the second paragraph and the third, and that's enough. You can do the rest by yourself. I want to end as we began with the verse of, I won't tell you which surah, you'll tell me, where Allah says, I am the first and I am the last. And I am that which is external and I am that which is internal. And I have knowledge of all things. هُوَ الْأَوَّلُ وَالْآخِرُ وَالظَّاهِرُ وَالْبَاطِنُ وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. That the beginning is therefore connected with the end. And if you want to study the state of the world today, if you want to penetrate the state of the world today, that is آخِرُ الزَّمَان, you've got to begin your studies with Awwal Zaman. This is the importance of today's seminar. And finally, that you cannot study the subject unless you have proper methodology. And proper methodology is the epistemology. Don't be afraid of this big word. The knowledge comes from both external and internal sources. And the externally acquired knowledge must be harmoniously integrated with the internally received knowledge. Majma'ul Bahrain, the place where the two oceans meet. And the example, the model of such scholarship in Akhiru Zaman is whom? Khidr alayhi salam. When I sat down with Mika and I introduced him to Khidr, I call him Mr. Green. And I introduced him to Khidr alayhi salam in the Quran. He said to me, but this is exactly Jesus. This man is just like Jesus, huh? Nabi Isa alayhi salam. So we'll end now. This is the epistemology. This is the methodology to be able to study the subject. If you don't have this methodology, you can't study the subject. Internal knowledge will only come when you have faith. And then Allah gives you nur, light. The nur is not sold in Migro. The nur cannot be bought in any supermarket. وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ. Allah watches the heart. And if the heart is sincere, and if you work for it, you plant, then you reap. Allah will give you nur. And with that nur, you'll now be able to receive knowledge internally. And then you can combine and harmoniously integrate the external with the internal knowledge. And follow in the footsteps of Khidr alayhi salam. And then you'll be able to study the subject successfully. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless our audience tonight, that you may be able to advance in knowledge as you study Akhiru Zaman with Awwalu Zaman. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka anta samir alim. وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين آمين. The question is there any presence in the beginning of history of Dajjal, that we can link it with the end of history, the false Messiah, the Antichrist? Do we find the Antichrist in the beginning of history, that we can link him with the end of history? The answer is that it is most certainly Dajjal, the false Messiah, or the Antichrist, who has created modern Western civilization. This is his civilization, which is built on a mysterious alliance between some Christians and some Jews. And the alliance is cemented with Zionism. So it's a Judeo-Christian-Zionist alliance. But there's little Christianity in it. It seems to be more godless than Christian. It seems to be more godless than Jewish. So you have to look outside of this alliance to find the true Christian and to find the true Jew. This civilization is led by people who are taking it in the direction of the tree, the prohibited tree. A lust to live forever and a lust to rule the world and to rule the world forever. Pax Britannica made way for Pax Americana, and Pax Americana is now making way for Pax Judaica, so that an Israel could seek to rule the world forever. So yes, Dajjal is most certainly present there. Maybe he is sitting on the tree. This is a brilliant comment that he has made. The question of 309 and 300. They slept for 300 years in the cave. It's also there in Christian scriptures. They slept for 300 years in the cave. Was there and some people add 9. This is to indicate that there is a solar year and there is a lunar year. And some people use the solar year for calculating time, and others use the lunar year for calculating time. There's no need for a boxing match. Put away your boxing gloves, fighting over which is the correct one, the solar year or the lunar year, because both have been created by Allah. This is why was there Lutisa. However, the other part of the subject is brilliant. They were using silver coins. We call them dirham in Arabic, darahim, dirham. And 300 years had passed, and in 300 years, which is 300 solar years, okay, there was no inflation. No inflation. So the money could still buy the food. Dajjal came and took this money out of the market in the end time, Akhiru Zaman. And Dajjal replaced it with another money. And when you paid your salary in that other money, it behaved in a very funny way. When you got your salary, you could buy, with 1 month's salary, you could buy a camel.
But then after a couple of years, the same salary can't buy a camel anymore. It can only buy a donkey. And then after some years, the same salary can't buy a donkey anymore. Can only buy a goat. And then if you know about Indonesia and Bangladesh, you know. After some years, you can't buy a goat anymore, you can only buy a chicken. The money is either leaking, the money is losing value. And as the money loses value, the value of your wage becomes less and less. The value of your property becomes less and less. Somebody is ripping you off. And three times in the Quran, Allah has prohibited this. He says, وَلَا تَبْخَسُ النَّاسَ أَشْيَاءَهُمْ. بَخْس. Do not decrease. Do not cause the value of people's property and wage to be constantly becoming less and less. Three times in the Quran. وَلَا تَبْخَسُ النَّاسَ أَشْيَاءَهُمْ. The reason why it becomes less and less is because you are being attacked with inflation. As the value of the money falls, the prices rise. Okay? Prices rise. And you are being ripped off. As prices rise, people's lives become more difficult. And as people have more difficult, Egypt just got a blow, a massive blow on the head. Egypt just got it. Egyptian pound fell by 50%. Yeah, just so you, 1 week ago. What happens is that after a certain time, people are alienated and they turn against the government. So if you want to rule the world and make sure that every government put their toe on the line and don't move off that line, you need a sword called inflation. And when they know that if they vote the wrong way in the United Nations, your money is going to start losing value, they know we must vote the correct way. Hugo Chavez in Venezuela said, no, I'm not going to be a slave. So Hugo Chavez in Venezuela, with matchless courage and integrity, dismissed them, resisted them. See what happened to the Venezuelan Bolivar? The Venezuelan Bolivar today is worth nothing. Robert Mugabe in Zimbabwe. For 20 years, he remained their little blue-eyed boy until the people became restless. They don't have the land, the white man has the land. And when he realized that there's a threat to his rule now, he then decided to abandon this slavish mentality, and he seized the land from the whites and he gave it to the black. But guess what happened to the Zimbabwe dollar? Huh? You know what happened? Yeah. I landed in Harare. I wanted to make a telephone call to tell my people I've arrived. So I have to change some South African rands to Zimbabwe dollars. And I asked her, how much does it cost to make a local telephone call? And they told me $2 million. Yeah. $2 million for one telephone call. So if you don't want your country to be like Zimbabwe and to be like Venezuela, you gotta behave yourself. You gotta submit to us, the rulers of the world. You gotta put your toe on the line and do what we tell you to do. That's why inflation is the most dangerous weapon that Allah, that Dajjal has ever created for ruling the world. And this comment of Dr. Zaman is very pertinent, because I didn't think of it before. That the reference in Surah Al-Kahf, that when the young man woke up from sleep after 300 solar years, they were hungry. You would also be hungry after 300 years. And they sent someone to buy some food. And the money that they gave that person, that still has its value intact, because they can still buy the food. And so the silver money they were, has retained its value after 300 years. And I never thought about it until my brother Jamal just told me about it. Thank you, Jamal. The second question pertaining to the Noor of Muhammad, Allah blessings be upon him, the light of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, being created at the beginning of history. There are several ahadith on the subject. For example, أول شيء ما خلق الله نوري. I give you one example. The first thing that Allah created was my Noor, my light. The problem is that our methodology for study is that we go first to the Qur'an, not to the Hadith. First to the Qur'an. And then we get all the data in the Qur'an pertaining to that subject of creation. And only after we have done that, and we have organized it as a harmonious whole, and located that which connects all the data together, only then do we go to that which is outside of the Qur'an, the Hadith. And then when we find a Hadith which is in harmony with the Qur'an, we accept it. When we find a Hadith which is in conflict with the Qur'an, we put it aside. Because the Qur'an alone has absolute authority. And when we find a Hadith which is neither in conflict nor in harmony, we accept it, but it has a lower status. This is our methodology. This particular subject about the creation of Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, that he was created even before Adam alayhi salam, that his Noor was created the first thing and so on, it does not have support in the Quran. When did Satan, or Iblis, when did he approach Adam to seduce him? The answer is that after he had seduced him, and Adam alayhi salam approached the tree, then Allah expelled them from paradise. اِهْبِتُوا مِنْهَا جَبِيعًا. Okay? وَإِنَّ لَكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مُسْتَقَبْلُ وَمَتَاءٌ إِلَى حِينٍ. So they were in paradise when they were approached by Iblis. Iblis has not as yet been expelled. Okay, I understand the question. If the macro Khilafah state cannot be established now, not even Russia can do it, even though Russia is returning to Orthodox Christianity, then what do we do? And my response was micro, until you could make macro. The micro, I said, would be a village. And the village is not only Muslims. No, Christians in the village, Jews in the village. Whoever wants to live with us is free to live with us on the condition that you respect the norms of public conduct in the village. You want to drink your alcohol? By all means, you can drink your alcohol. Do it at home. Do it at home. We're not going to prohibit you from drinking your wine. I mean, we're going to be drinking wine if we go to heaven, don't we? Huh? Yes? Rivers of wine. Rivers of wine in heaven. So, we say to you, drink your wine, but at inside your home. Because we don't want any public consumption of wine in this village, okay? And this way we live together as a family, while in the village, attempting as best as we can to follow the way of life which is based on the truth, and that truth did not come in the Qur'an for the first time. Oh no! The truth had been coming so many years before, it has come for the last time in the Qur'an. But in the Qur'an, the truth which has come in the Qur'an attempts to correct any distortion of the truth which came before. Like, for example, lending money on interest. If you find in any of the previous scriptures anything which supports money being lent on interest, you know that didn't come from the Lord God. Somebody wrote it there. So the Qur'an has come to correct what is there in previous scriptures which has been distorted. Okay? One of the subjects which we are going to my brother Misha to speak on tonight is the one about the forbidden tree. Because you have one version of the forbidden tree in the previous scriptures, and you have another version of the forbidden tree in the Qur'an. And I don't want to speak for the previous scriptures, no, let someone else speak for them. What our eschatology has done tonight in turning to the beginning of history is to give us an explanation of the historical process which is more valid and makes more sense than any other. It is with the rational faculty that we will examine and validate or invalidate any claim to truth. It is with the rational faculty we will do it. And so we invite mankind to take a look. This is our reading and our explanation of the historical process. This is how the beginning of history is impacting on the end of history. However, when we offer the explanation, we do not do so with the point of a sword. We say, if you are impressed with it, you are convinced with it, you are convinced that it is truth, then accept it. But unless you are convinced that it is the truth, we say don't accept it. No. This is not any dogma being propagated here at all.
The first thing is as long as we know that if the hadith conforms to the Quran, then we take it and we can study it. If it doesn't conform to the Quran, we have to leave it aside for other research. If it neither conforms nor opposes the Quran, then we can use it in some other way. But we have to expand this science, this method of looking into other factors of how to determine how to authenticate hadith.
The only thing I will add is what Allah Himself says in the Quran: "Fas'al ahlu dhikri in kuntum la ta'lamun." If you don't know, then go to those who have the knowledge of the Quran.
Because of my bad English, I will probably make mistakes.
Never mind.
Okay, the problem of knowledge is central in Orthodox Christianity. The tree in the paradise was the tree of knowledge of good and evil. The problem of knowledge is central because the first statement we can say about God is that nobody knows God. And the school who teaches that nobody knows God have a name, it's called apophatic school. So when we refer to God, we first think and remember that we don't know anything about Him. And we'll finish the same way. We have very different teachings in Islam and Christianity. And this is the beauty to confront and discuss about it. The methodology you're teaching to your students, it's, I can tell you, as a Christian, it is fantastic. It has a name in Christianity. It has a Greek name, which is Catholicon. Catholic. That means that when you interpret a verse, you interpret it by the whole. Catholicon, by the whole. That means that there's not one single word which is the truth, but you have to read it with the Spirit. And in this perspective, we are maybe very close, Orthodox Christians, and the teaching of the Sheikh Imran Hosein. So, I want to add something about the Dajjal. It's linked to the theme, to the subject. When God created the world, He used angels. And we believe that Satan, the devil, is an angel. But whatever he is, whatever he was, he had the idea, he wanted to help God to create the world with knowledge, with wiseness, with whatever he knew at that time. So he decided to help God to create the perfect world. And then God came and said, "And now bow before Adam, my last creation." How is it possible? An angel with a wiseness, intelligence, force, power will bow before a man made of dust? No. Nobody who is intelligent can accept that. That's what have done the devil. He decided not to listen to God and to offer to the world his idea of perfection. Yes, we can make the world perfect without God. That's the plan of the devil. That's the plan of the devil. That's the root of every utopia. That's the root of socialism, is the root of communism, is the root of encyclopedism, enlightenment, whatever you want. But we, like a Christian and like a faithful people, we don't believe in human wiseness. So when Adam and Eve ate the fruit of knowledge, they only discovered how poor they are, how weak they are, how false they are, and they were banished from paradise. And this, and thus they could not access to the tree of life, which is in paradise. The reason of that, then the mortality starts. The reason of that is that God doesn't want the man to be unhappy and wrong forever. So death is a gift of God, yes?
Death is a gift of God.
Yes. Absolutely. And you said that. And it's the teaching also of the Orthodox Church. And we have the gift of death, and we have, of course, the gift of life, which is the river of wine, which is waiting us in paradise. So, in the Quran, when I read, when Sheikh first time read me some verse of the Quran, I noticed that it's very close to the Christian teaching. And that the Christ described in the Quran, it's not at all as the heretical Christ we Christians are teaching that you are teaching. The Christ in the Quran is the Orthodox Christ. Oh, this is very shocking. I hope for you and hope for the Christian too. Yes. Yes. And I believe that there is many differences between us, but there is one more similarity I wanted to point. Do you remember the three river of paradise? You have one river of water, a river of milk, and a river of wine. Oh, this is a very Christian teaching too. The Christ said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And I believe he refers to these three rivers. And in Christianhood, we have a spiritual path which is made of three steps. And this is the three steps: the cleaning, the teaching, and unity. Time for unity is maybe to come between people of goodwill. I recognize all your differences. We are very different in many ways. I want to give a testimony to finish. I'm Serbian. Before the war in Yugoslavia, I was walking in Belgrade and I could feel the smell of war. You can feel it, really. Before the war, you know that the war will happen. And these days are very precious because it's the time to go toward your friends, your different friend, your Muslim friend, your Catholic friend, and to speak with them. It's now time to speak with them. Because when the war starts, it's too late. So please, have a jest. Have a.
You're talking about the Great War.
About the Great War and about any war. It's before the war that we have to do something with our friend. So I believe that your teaching looks like what we call Catholic in the Greek sense, not in the Roman Catholic sense. And the Catholic, that means that if I recognize the truth in your speak, in your speech, I'm so happy about that. And I hope we can all be happy if we learn to listen to each other. Because in our teachings, and few Christians are aware of that, what is the first commandment of all? Every Christian knows the answer. He will say, love God and love the prochain. The next one. But the word of the Christ are introduced by this way. He said, listen, Israel. So listen, people. There's no love without listening, your brother. If you learn to listen, your brother, then you can say that you loved him. If you never listen to him, don't claim that you love him. Because love without listening, it's a fraudulent love. So learn to listen. I listen Sheikh, I'm happy of his teaching. I regret that such a man didn't came 20 years before to work on peace. But it's not too late. I'm happy that you listen to me. I'm happy of every word you said, and I want to say thank you.
May I ask him two questions?
Yeah,
we're not finished with you. the first question,
Misha, can you comment on the figure of Khidr, or I spoke of it, Mr. Green, in Islam?
Yes, I'm sorry because I maybe don't remember everything. I'll do my best. Maybe you can help me.
You told me when I described Mr. Green, Khidr, the most learned of all men. Moses said, I am the most learned. The Lord God said, no, you are not. There's one more learned than you. And you'll find him at the place where the two oceans meet.
I will come into this point. First, we Christians believe that when God spoke to the humankind, it is God himself, of course, but it is the word of God. So I believe that this Mr. Green, as you said, Khidr looks like Christ to me.
That's what
but I may be wrong. He lives at the border of two waters.
Mm.
But we know that when God created the world, he first created two waters, the waters up down and the waters up up. That means for me, and that's the way I do interpret it, is the human nature of the world and the divine nature of the world. Because the word of God is divine, but it's also human. It says in human languages. So that's why the Khidr is put between two waters.
Mm.
Can we go further?
Mm.
You never told me this before, first time I'm here. The second one is, we were introduced in today's seminar to the concept of a khilafah state, meaning a state in which governance is based on truth, rule is based on truth, law is based on truth. We in the world of Islam long to restore that khilafah state. What is the state of the Orthodox Christian world?
First, I would like to say it's very good to try to restore this. But the Christians, we know that we will fail. Our kingdom is not on this earth. We will fail. But we can find a way to save ourselves. And the point, it's fantastic because Sheikh Imran is the first one I've heard about that. He said, when you have a debt, you're on the wrong way. You shouldn't have any debt. You shouldn't accept to take a debt on you. We Christian, we believe that nobody can escape the debt. But we say, if somebody owns you, you forgive him. You erase the debt. And not only we say that, but we say that every day, 10 times a day. It is in our prayer, which is called Our Father. And when the prayer in the Orthodox Church, it's not falsified, like in the Catholic world. We don't say, forgive us our offense. We don't say that. We say, forgive us our debt, as we erase the debt of our...
Mashallah.
We say that every day, 10 times a day. So one way to escape the debt, of course, I have a debt with my parents because I'm living. I have a debt with Sheikh because I'm learning from him. We all have debt. But if somebody owns you, please forgive him. Let him, make him a gift. And that's what I believe Putin does when he erased the debt of Cuba. He erased the debt of Cuba, and I won't, if any state in Europe pretend to be Christian, to erase the debt of the third world country.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you are not Christian.
Mashallah.
Sheikh, we only have another 10 minutes in the room, so
yeah.
We can.
Okay, I know you got lots of questions on the US elections. So before we only have another 10 minutes. So let me just briefly comment on it. Briefly. I think there will be few who would differ that if the US elections had gone the other way, we would have been facing war with Russia, certain war with Russia. And war with Russia will obviously be nuclear war. Those who control the media, radio, television, newspapers, the polls, they all waged a furious campaign in support of the other side, wanting, therefore, a result from the US election which would have led to war with Russia. The first comment I have to make is that we could no longer say that all the American people are like sheep. Because despite the most massive effort at brainwashing that we have ever witnessed in an election, a majority of the American people emerged out of it with sanity intact. Sanity meaning, we don't want a nuclear war. And that is a hopeful sign, that if the American people can resist brainwashing from the media and from government and so on, the same thing can happen in France tomorrow. I hope it does. The same thing can happen in Germany tomorrow. I hope it does. And those who are lusting for war with Russia will suddenly find that despite all the efforts that they make, the majority of the people reject them. Surely this is a hopeful sign that with the cause for the human brain and the human mind is not lost. The people can still think. If this is possible for nuclear war, that they can recognize what is being done, this is also possible for the truth which is in Islam and the truth which is in Orthodox Christianity. That people who previously have been brainwashed that Islam is only terrorism, and Orthodox Christianity, they've been waging war on Orthodox Christianity for the longest while. These people can now wake up and realize, no, this is demonization. Let me take another look at Islam. Let me take another look at Orthodox Christianity. Let me take another look at what is true Judaism, okay? My second comment is that we should be thankful to the Lord God who has saved us and given us a breathing spell, because I know they're going to come with their war agenda. It's only a matter of time. So we should thank Allah that we have a little time. I call it a window of sunlight in a world which has been growing darker and darker all the time. I don't know how long this window of sunlight would last. This is not to say that I am praising Trump as a great man and this and that. No. But the man said, I see no reason why we cannot have good relations with Russia. It makes sense to me. Yes. He said, I think we should have an audit of the Federal Reserve. Oh yes, I think that makes a lot of sense. Yes. He said that we should put a bar on immigration. Nobody wants that your country should be overrun with people from outside who have a different way of life from yours. This is your country. And so the reaction to this massive immigration is totally understandable. I would do the same thing. If people come to me as refugees, yes, we open the door for refugees. And we keep them, we help them as much as we can. But not this massive state. The rest of the world is coming to Europe. Why? Because they're destitute. And you are the ones who made them destitute. So now you're coming and you're saying, well, the only thing we can do to stop the whole of Africa from coming to Europe is a Marshall Plan for Africa. What rubbish. A Marshall Plan for Africa, what rubbish. You have to recognize that you are the ones who ripped them off. Stop the rip-off. Bring back money with integrity. Stop the banking system from ripping off the people, okay? Bring back trade which is mutually beneficial, not trade which is like a vacuum that you use for cleaning the carpet, sucking the wealth of all of mankind unjustly. That's what they've done, okay? So at least Trump is saying, let us stop this immigration which is inundating the United States and inundating Europe as well. I agree with that. There are millions of Syrian refugees. Why can't they go back home? I'm sure they'd love to go back home and live in Syria rather than live in Belgium. For them to go back home, we've got to stop the war. Who started the war? Come on, stop lying. Stop your monstrous lies. Who started the war? Who's been fueling the war all the time? And thank God for Trump. For Putin. Had it not been for Russia, Syria would have been another Libya by now. And those of you who are happy about what has happened to Libya, I don't want to see your ugly faces. No. Libya is another NATO state now. And you're thankful for that with your bogus jihad, with money coming from Santa Claus, and weapons coming from Santa Claus. It's time for somebody to raise their voice and speak the truth. And if I am honored to do that, alhamdulillah. So these are my initial comments on Trump. I hope they have an audit of the Federal Reserve. But if they do, I know they'll kill him. They'll kill him. Yeah. I hope that he will meet with Putin and they'll be able to build a bond between them. I hope that the relations between the United States and Russia will become better. And I hope that the same phenomenon will come to France and Germany and we get the warmongers out of government. Yeah.
Thank you, Baulina, and thank you everyone for your attendance. Our time is unfortunately up. If you do have any further questions, I'm sure everyone knows Sheikh's email address. Please do email it to him. We'll also add you, if you registered, to the students' mailing list. There are already several hundred students who have attended previous programs on there. And you can then pose your questions there and also interact with some of the other students. So if you could ask Maulana just to make a closing dua.
Would you allow me to ask Jamal to make it small dua?
Inshallah, Sheikh.
ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. We thank thee, O Allah, for this seminar which has been blessed to be a successful seminar, a peaceful seminar. We thank thee, O Allah, for the chance to be able to meet as brothers and as sisters in an atmosphere of peace and of love. We pray to thee, O Allah, that as a result of this seminar, our knowledge of the truth may be increased and that we be more rightly guided. We beg of thee, O Allah, to protect all those who have been here attending this seminar from all harm. Take them back safely to their homes, far and wide as they may be, and keep them safe from harm. We thank thee, O Allah, for the companionship and friendship of our brother Misha, and pray that the alliance between Muslims and Orthodox Christians will be enhanced day by day. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad wa barik wa sallim. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Thank you, Misha, for coming. Thank you very much.